And she's, well, she's coming all the way from Camden, Maine. She's no stranger to living in New Hampshire. I was thrilled to hear that she actually lived for a number of years right around the corner in the neighborhood here.
Yep.
And you used to come with your children to Ava's Saturday Chaos program.
Yep.
That is the Chaos Without an H Community Arts Open Studio. And so it is, so we really already have had the connection with you here and the building, and it's just wonderful to welcome you back here. Ava's exhibition coordinator, Margaret Jacobs, who worked with Ingrid in planning and setting up the show, will introduce her a little more formally. But for now, thank you for a beautiful show and welcome all of you to this talk. Hey, Margaret, it's on to you.
Ingrid Elson is a painter and arts instructor working in oil, mixed media, and printmaking. She was born in Boston, Massachusetts, and currently resides in Camden, Maine. She received her bachelor's from Skidmore College and her MFA from American University. She also studied printmaking in Florence, Italy, and has participated in residencies and workshops at the Vermont Studio Center in Johnson, Vermont, Maine College of Art in Portland, and Castle Hill Center for the Arts in Truro, Massachusetts. Ellison shows regularly throughout Maine, including recent exhibitions at the Center for Maine Contemporary Art in Rockland, the University of Maine in Bangor, and the Cynthia Winings Gallery in Blue Hill. Her work has been featured on the cover of ArtScope magazine and has been included in several other publications, including Maine Home and Design and Sacramento Bee. Please join me in welcoming Ingrid.
Thank you, Margaret, and thank you, Benta. It is so cool to be here at Ava, and it's so cool to see my name on a wall, because it's never happened before. And so whoever did that for me, I am forever in your debt. I want to put it in my kitchen. I think it's really neat. And I did used to live about 2 blocks from here, right on Union Street. And my son actually went to kindergarten in this building when Runnymede School was here. So that's fun. And so I'm here. So I thought I would tell you a little bit about me, because that's why you're here, and how this particular body of work came into being, and some of my studio practices, where I draw information from when I'm making my paintings. So about a year and a half ago, I think I was feeling like I was at one of those crossroads of life. I had just completed a large body of work and sent that out into the world. I had nearly completed raising my 2 kids and sent them out into the world even though they're not done. And I was about to turn 50. And I wanted to mark these milestones in some kind of meaningful way and find my way back into my paintings. So I set up a number of projects for myself over that summer. And one was to paint 50 paintings. And these were all the same size. They were 6 by 6 inches on paper, and they were an opportunity for me to just play around with different materials, different imagery, new color combinations for me, and they were just kind of fun. It was really great not to have any rules self-imposed, other than that I had to make 50 of them, and I didn't have any rules of what could or couldn't go on a painting, so I was open to neon and glitter and transfers and all sorts of things that don't normally find their way into my oil paintings. And so even after I finished the 50, I continued working in this format just because I liked the immediacy of it. I could go in the studio and sort of make a few of them, kind of drawing from whatever was lying around, and whatever sort of caught my eye. So the next thing I did was I wanted to set up some interaction with other artists, and I wanted to go away. So I signed up for two painting workshops at the Castle Hill Center for the Arts in Truro on the Cape, which is in a beautiful setting. And the first was a week with the artist Deborah Dancy, who's on faculty at UConn. And the second was with the painter Joan Snyder, whose work I'd admired for a long time. Both were pretty compact weeks. A lot of work concentrated into a short amount of time, kind of like graduate school in a nutshell. And I worked pretty quickly here, initially with collage and water-based medium and just sort of looking through piles of photocopy images. And I came across this one, which is a pile of folded up newspapers. And I didn't really know it at the time, but that kind of image and that mark of those curvy, kind of scallopy mark would sort of come to inhabit almost all my paintings throughout the next whole year. So here it is as a collage element. And that's about 12 by 12, just so for your reference. A little funny bit. And here again, I'm starting to draw it and I'm starting to paint it and then I'm using different colors with it. These were all about 24 inches square. And I wasn't making anything to sort of make a painting at this point. I was just kind of experimenting on all these different pieces of paper. And these are some smaller ones. So there's more variations in the grid. There's more kind of colors that I don't usually paint in pink. I love the color pink, but I never use it. And so all these things, this was just still this experimental mode as far as I was concerned. So at the end of my second workshop, I packed up my car and started driving home and I got about 5 miles down the road and I stopped. I'm not really ready to go back. So I turned around and I went to the beach and I just wanted to go swimming. And I went in the water and it was super choppy and waded out past the seaweed and this huge swell came and I was lifted off the ground and immediately the word unmoored came into mind. And I was like, huh, that's kind of how I feel. You know, you're at these two workshops that are really intense and a lot of information coming at you. And so I just needed to go home and kind of process all that in my own space and time. So I went back to Maine, where it's often gray and foggy, and got into my own studio and started going about my routine, which includes walking the dogs every day down by the harbor. And I started to notice things that began to inform more of my work, kind of like this spider web. I thought that arc of the spider web that's kind of dew covered was sort of echoing the curves that I discovered in the newspaper. And I made this painting about time, which felt a little collage-like in the way I pieced the various elements together. It is just paint, but I was sort of thinking more like a collage when I was putting shapes on the panel and using that scallop. And then I had this old newspaper picture of a trout that had been on my wall for years, and I decided to cut up and use it. And I was just still kind of messing around with these things that were grabbing my attention, and I remembered this phrase that someone told me once, pay attention to what the universe is trying to tell you, or pay attention to what's grabbing your attention. And as I say in my artist statement, I am kind of surrounded by these harbors and shipyards and vessels and et cetera, et cetera. And I've never really had them in my work. And I thought about letting them come into my paintings, which is just sort of weird. I mean, I've lived in Maine for almost 9 years. And I grew up sailing, and I think the last time I ever drew or painted a boat was probably when I was 12. So I was finding ways of letting this kind of imagery that I'm surrounded by come into the work. Finding things like, you know, fishing line that washed up on shore, where I just think that's beautiful. It's kind of like an octopus, sort of. And so I have these images that I bring home, and I don't ever really intend to paint a portrait of this, but I do kind of let it maybe inform some of the line that the brush makes on the paintings. This is a larger piece, it's about 4 feet square. And then the colors, these dots, they get pulled in the wintertime and they just sit, and they just have this beautiful, like, decayed blue where the foam has gotten rusty and the wood is kind of worn out. And this is my ghost ship, which is, I think this is here. And I think this is the first time I thought of actually putting in like a rendering of a boat, and there's sort of an upside down hull kind of drawn in the upper right on this one. So this is my studio, which Julia actually helped me find my studio, and thankfully it came with a house, so we bought it. And so things were starting to come together in the studio. I had a bunch of pieces going at once because I work in oil, so I have to, you know, dry slowly. So I'm kind of working on about anywhere between 3 and 6 paintings all at once. And I was honing in on this color palette that were based on all the colors in the images on the coastline. You know, looking at these kind of crazy, wiggly, marks that I just like. And I was at a bookstore and I saw this book, and this is like, pay attention, you know? So, and I love the cover and I love the title. And I actually read the book and I love the book. It's sort of this epic saga of seafaring set in Denmark in the late 1800s, early 1900s. And I liked it so much that I named this painting after it, which is around the corner here. And there's actually some little drawn feet in the right-hand side of this painting that you may or may not see here. We can go find them in real life. Shapes or images that pique my curiosity, I feel like I can't kind of get enough of it, and I want to draw things over and over, and I think it's kind of like when you give a baby a little object that they've never held before, and they'll look at a cup for like an hour, and you're like, it's a cup, you know? And so I tend to draw these shapes over and over and over again because I don't really want to taste a bait bag. In my mouth to figure it out, but I have to draw it or paint it, or every once in a while I'll make little like objects that, you know, refer to it. And it's just sort of my way of figuring it out until I exhaust it. And then I make the jump sometimes onto bigger pieces. And this one is, it's about, I think it's 3 feet square. And this has those net-like forms that are sort of 2D, but they also like sort of show a volume because you can see the traces of older drawings underneath. And I like that kind of a little bit of confusion in there. And I get another one, which is sort of like the opposite version of it, being light on dark versus dark on light. And even though these aren't the same size, I really like how they hang together. They just are sort of like mirrors of each other, anyway. back to that vessel. These are a couple of dories that are out in the water in Rockland Harbor in a horrible rainstorm. And this is probably one of the few times that I actually used a picture to dictate a composition. But I really liked the pairing of these two hulls. I like thinking about what happens on the inside of that arc versus on the outside of that arc and what that line looks like where it meets, whether it's holding water or displacing water. I like thinking about those when I use those kinds of shapes. And also on this painting, and I think the few others, it's part of these three that are on this back wall, there's this little piece of little pieces of paint that come right down the center in a long triangle, and think of that as like little shafts of light, which is why I called it deck prism. Which, if you don't know, a deck prism is it's this piece of glass that's shaped like a prism, and it's inverted into the deck of a boat. So if light comes in, it refracts the light into the hull, so you can see inside. So more patterns, erosion in stone, and this kind of pattern, you know, sometimes I'll let it cover the entire surface on top of something else. And I like to play around the scale of things. This is a really teeny painting. It's 6 by 6 inches. And then this beautiful hall laid to rest. In a field at my friend's house, and those ribs are so beautiful, like a human rib cage, and seeing the exposed ribs allowed me to sort of superimpose it on whatever kind of ground I wanted, so it was more see-through than about that whole vessel that floats. Another one like that. This one's not here. And I like this little moon on the top and like a diving man. I don't know why he's there, but I like it. I showed you the docks that are pulled in the water, and this is what's left over, the pilings. And I just like how these are like marching little soldiers in the water, and they just stand there all winter long. They're kind of lonely out there. But I do look a lot at these kind of verticals and how they can sort of divide up the space, and I think I put some of these in paintings sometimes, or I work off of a grid, not completely, like I don't grid the whole thing off, but I'll think in terms of gridding and bars to kind of divide the space. This is Rep Seas. It's a 24 inches square. And it has that inside-outside element of the vessel, of something being displaced, something displacing the water. And the gold is an underpainting that I've scratched down into. Another photo of the harbor in Rockland, because I just love that starkness of blue and white. And obviously, because that's the paintings are all blue and white. And also, you always see these big sweeping like views, and see it's like sideways from the snow up to the water, you know, sort of a big sideways, you know, U shape on the panel. So I just think that's something I always love. And so I wanted to show you a little bit about the evolution of a painting. So you think, or I might think even, that when I have all these tools and images at my disposal, that the paintings will sort of kind of go. And they don't, usually not. And so I have a series of slides that are just, they're more snapshots of the quality's not quite as good, but, and bear with me on the first one, it's a little blurry, but I really wanted to show you this evolution. So this is like what I call the first date. And I'm actually never afraid to start a new piece. I spend a lot of time sanding and gessoing and sanding and gessoing, so I get a really nice slick surface, and it's just, I love it. And so making those first marks is just super exciting, and like you're gonna meet someone new for the first time, and the conversation is great because you don't know anything about them, and they like you and you like them, and it's all happy. And the second date goes pretty well. You're, you know, adding a little bit more background information. You don't really know where it's going at all. And the third date, maybe it, you know, maybe you said too much, so things get covered up and they go away. And then this sits for a while, and it's turned to the wall, and you know, you forget about it, and then you think you need to finish it. And by then, the time has passed, so that initial kind of momentum is shifted, and so you do something kind of dumb, and you kind of start painting something completely different. It's like the mood that you were going with at first has changed because you left it for too long, and so now you're picking up in this whole new spot. And this is when it's tough, and there's a lot of scraping, and there's a lot of painting over, and there's thoughts of abandonment. And then you get a one last go, and it ended up here. So, but it's not always a really fluid process. It's a little bit of torture involved, I think. And the last thing I wanted to share with you all is what I do in my in-between time. So in between paintings, I keep these books. And these are a little hand journal that's the brand. They're 6 by 6 inches square, and I work in these all the time. They come with me wherever I go. And so if I, sometimes I'll paint my painting in process so I can kind of see it in a different thing. You know, like if you take a picture of a painting and you look at it on your screen, you're like, oh, that's what that looks like. So often I'll draw from my paintings and put that in here. I'll pick up elements that are in the studio or grocery lists or letters. I try to get something down every day so that even if the paintings aren't happening, there's this conversation is continuing. So I might not be working on something big, but my brain is working on figuring out color combinations or patterns or, you know, obsessively drawing this scallop mark that is pathological at this point. And there's just, they're easy because I'm not hanging them. You know, they're just folded up in my bag most of the time. And there's that open and immediacy that these hold for me that I don't quite get when I paint on larger painting, but I also don't get that really seductive oil paint finish on these. So I wouldn't really give one up for the other. They're both part of my process. These are anything from watercolor, gouache, tape, printing, spray, anything, really anything. Glitter, you can see glitter in this one. Collage, really anything. Gouache and ink are sort of the two big basics for me. I like how gouache dries, it's a little choppy, so you can write on it really nicely. And
That was really cool seeing your process.
Oh, thank you.
And those journals, you do workshops on them.
I do, yeah, I did, and I just had two full-day workshops last weekend in working in those
But were some of them weekly, like people would come to the studio weekly?
I did a weekly. I've done a lot of classes in these. This is my favorite size. Mm-hmm. I don't know why. It fits in my bag. I've done a lot of classes in them, just kind of using different... They are.
You'll be glittery after you visit me and hug me.
because why not, you know? You can't see it on that. You're welcome to look at it. You don't have to really read what's in it, but if you want to peruse it. I have stacks of them. I always say if there's a fire in my house, that's the only thing I'm taking. And I've been keeping them for about maybe 4 or 5 years now. So all the same. And yes, I've done workshops with all sorts of different, you know, adults and kids with them on weekly basis. And then this last weekend when I had the day-long ones, that was the first time I ever had a day-long, that kind of format, which was really fun. Thank you.
What was the name of the book again that you showed about?
Oh, We the Drowned. We the Drowned, yeah. It's about that thick. It's a good winter book, you know, because you're not, you know, when you're sitting inside. It's really great. It starts out with this kind of magical story of a man that he's sailing along and he gets sent up into heaven. And he's up there for a while and he's with St. Peter at the gates and stuff. And then he comes back down to earth in these boots, and his boots save him. And the boots are part of the story for the entire, you know, tomb that it is. It's just, so they're always referring to his sort of his magic boots. But it's kind of an actual account of what seafaring was like in Denmark, you know, and it was horrible. And, you know, they're getting all the boys that have been in, you know, abused and yelled at and beaten at school come, and then they think they're getting out of that school and they go on the boat. It's just as bad or worse because now they're like vomiting because it's, you know, so scary. But it's a great book. Happy ending. Yeah.
So are there certain papers that you particularly connect with?
That's always a good question. I think now with like looking so much, you get inundated really with looking at so many different people's work. I like sometimes like an artist like Kiki Smith, how she takes sort of one thing and examines it in all different mediums, like, you know, she's casting, she's sculpting, she's printmaking, she's drawing, and I like that kind of all-encompassing, like that's just what, you know, it's like that's her curiosity. I sort of like to see where, why people make stuff rather than, you know, well, that's a pretty painting. I do like pretty paintings, yeah, anyways.
It was interesting to me because when I was looking at your work, I've been doing a lot of looking at Anne Silman, who's a painter.
Amy Silman. I do love her work.
And how there was just a resonance for me in the fact that like she also takes her language and translates it into the digital, like animated painting.
Okay.
She does. And,
yeah.
And so to see your paintings and your book.
And well, I'll take that as a great compliment because I really like her work. So that's cool. Yeah.
I really like little journal sharing. Have you thought about putting that together as kind of a little series, maybe as digital prints or something?
The only thing I've thought of with that is in a book format. And the reason I have thought about that is there's a photographer named Sig Harvey who, she lives in Maine, and she just published a book called Gardening at Night. And it's so ethereal. It's so
beautiful. She makes beautiful photographs, and she writes in this just sort of stream of consciousness way of, you know, that go, so they sort of plod their way through the photos, and it doesn't, you know, I think if one person were gonna look at the portfolio of photos, you wouldn't say like, well, this is the order that they go in, you know, but because her language goes along with it, they have this really beautiful progression. And I don't pretend that I could write like that, but I like the idea of it, you know, so maybe.
Yeah, I'd love to see that.
Yeah, I would love to see a lot of things.
And that was Sig Harvey that you
heard? Sig Harvey, yeah, C-I-G Harvey. She's taught a lot at main media workshops, and she used to be on faculty at one of the schools in Boston, maybe the Art Institute, I think. Yeah. We good? Okay.
Well, thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Today's the last day.